kept doing, even up until the end, the last season, they were still doing it, and they never really, I don't know. It was, I wasn't happy with Arya killing her. A lot of people, oh yeah, you know, girl power, but I'm like, it was weird.
I apologize, my friend. There was a button I didn't press, so everything we just said was just for us.
Okay.
I'm bad at this. We're live now. Hello, everybody. It is WRH Live. I am the world-renowned historian. We are here talking with my great friend, the great and powerful Joey Hernandez. Long story short, sorry about that, Joey.
No, it's fine.
But we're on now. That's you're not a streamer unless you have incredible tech retardation issues like that. So just to catch everybody up, I would say we both had mixed feelings about the final season of Game of Thrones. On balance, positive, and a big problem with it is that so much was rushed because they only had 9 hours to finish everything up.
Right.
Yes. All right.
Which you mentioned, it could just be, you know, the restraints that HBO put on D&D.
Indeed. Yeah. You were making a point. We're live now. I'm sorry.
No. It's okay. No problem. I think we were talking about the White Walkers, how that whole thing just kind of went away without any kind of fanfare. It felt like they built up this great mythology and then just did nothing with it.
Absolutely. They just kind of swept them right off.
Yeah.
It was a great episode, but it was just too fast.
Yeah. A little, and I will echo some of the complaints that I've heard about it being a little bit too dark. And by dark, I mean literally dark. It was kind of, there was times like I didn't know what was going on, especially with the dragon stuff. I'm like, you know, plus, didn't one of the dragons actually get, like, ravaged by a lot of the walkers? What happened with that? Like, I thought that one was a goner.
So there was the one that they killed and turned into a zombie dragon.
Right.
And then there was two, right? And then the other one got killed by like Cersei's like side piece, the Greyjoy guy.
Right.
And then was the third one was just like the last survivor?
I'm not Drogon, sure. Yeah, that was her, that was kind of her baby.
Yeah.
No, but one of them during the actual battle, I don't know if you remember, got getting kind of ravaged by a bunch of, like, got overpowered.
Right.
Kind of like the horse in the first episode of The Walking Dead. So I just assumed that one was done. And then there he was the next episode.
Which is the one that... there had to be two, right? Because she and John were both riding them.
Right.
Like, in the battle. And they both, like, fly, like, way high. Like, I don't know. It's kind of running together at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So you were mostly satisfied with the ending. You were...
You know, the final episode, I'll be honest. Initially, my initial reaction, my knee-jerk reaction was, what the hell was that?
Really?
What? it was kind of like Sprouts. It was the same thing. With my initial, right after, you know, the HBO boom, was like, really?
Yeah.
That's it? Yeah. But that was one that after I kind of digested it a little bit, the ending I think was fine. To tell you the truth, I wish that there was more of that, of the Daenerys, because like the scenes with the the new council. I love that shit. I wish there was more of the what happens now kind of thing.
I don't mean to interrupt you. My friend Harrison is in the chat. He says that that was Drogon that got swamped and Danny fell off. But he did survive.
Oh,
okay. So that was the last one who ended up melting the throne at the end.
Yeah.
He got hit by the giant crossbow, and then I guess he got swamped when he went down.
Oh, okay.
Anyways, yeah. That answers that. But you were saying, sir. I apologize for interrupting.
No. I was done.
Yeah, I think that... Man, it's so hard to, like, finish stuff like this. Like, it's almost like as a writer or a creator, like, the worst thing that can happen to you is getting really, really popular. Because then, like the fans are going to be, like, hanging on every single moment. And if you don't, like, fulfill their theories, if you don't let them essentially write it for you, like, they're going to have this, like, rage reaction, right? It's like, it's Star Wars syndrome, essentially. Like, with Force Awakens, they got what they wanted. They just got a new hope. And then Last Jedi comes along, right. And it's like, no, we're going to throw in all this new crazy stuff that's never been a part of Star Wars, and there's going to be this, like, crazy backlash against it. We're like, no, we don't want any of that. We don't want anything new.
Yeah.
You know, Lost dealt with that to an extent. I think Breaking Bad, maybe to a smaller extent, but... I think people were on the whole pretty satisfied with that ending.
But yeah, as a counterpoint, Breaking Bad seems like the one show that those that have watched it, I haven't heard anything negative about it except for you know, maybe wanting more. But as far as the finale, I think they kind of pretty much nailed it. I think that was a near perfect finale.
Yeah, it's hard to imagine a better one. It's hard to remember a better one.
But they're
really hard. Yeah, they're really hard to do. Because if you have these obsessed fans like this, and you don't fulfill all their fan theories, if it doesn't fit into their idea of perfect in this, like, Comic-Con culture that we're in now, where, like, the release of trailers is, like, this big event, you know...
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, fandom is so strange now. Like, I don't remember that when we were kids. Like, I didn't go to Independence Day thinking, like, oh, if Will Smith and Jeff Goldblum aren't flying together at the end, I'm going to be so mad. Like,
right.
That we just didn't do that back then. But now, like, I don't know where it started, but that's the world we live in now, you know?
But, you know, I think a lot of it, too, depends on the fandom because I totally agree with you. That's just kind of where we're living at. But like, if you look at Endgame, you know, think of all the theories and weird things that people thought was going to happen going up to Endgame. And a lot of that shit just went totally out the window. But I think Endgame was pretty, even without honoring, you know, a lot of the fans' theories and stuff, I think that... they did kind of manage to, I mean, not universally, but more so than Game of Thrones.
No, you're right. You're absolutely right about that. And I don't mean to suggest all the negative reaction to the Last Throne season was due to that. I'm just saying that's a component of it. That's an element of it.
You know, I even kind of wonder, actually, if Endgame kind of tilted, because let's be honest, the fandoms intersect there. Most people definitely. Who watch Endgame were watching every Sunday Game of Thrones too.
Yeah.
So I kind of tend to wonder if maybe that might have helped with the tipping a little bit of the negative response because they didn't get that. Because, you know, like you and I have talked about, Endgame was just a total love letter. But Game of Thrones absolutely was not. And maybe that was kind of that was a little bit the people... we're on a high because of Endgame and I don't know.
I'm sympathetic to the theory that Endgame gave the fans almost exactly what they wanted. And it's been George R. R. Martin's kind of mantra with the story the whole time is like, no, you're not going to get what you want. People get shitty endings. Right. Ned Stark gets his head cut off. Like, why did you think this was all going to turn out how you want it? Like, I'm sorry.
Right.
Like, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wonder. Go ahead. I haven't read any of the books. Did have they gone into to John's parentage in the books at all, or hinted at it at all?
Oh gosh, I don't think so. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but not that I recall. I've read all of the first three, part of the fourth one, and all of the fifth one, and I don't recall it being mentioned.
Maybe it wasn't. Maybe that was just something D&D did, again, to satisfy fans. And then just that's why it didn't go anywhere.
Yeah.
I've been hearing that for years.
What's
about
that?
You know, way before the John's parents being Targaryen and Tyrion.
Yeah.
That, you know, I've been hearing that theory for forever. And then they did it, and then, like, you know, like you said, I don't remember if we talked about that before, but then they just kind of did. What was the point of that?
Yeah, like it had nothing at all to do with like his. It was almost just like a red herring. It was just like, this leads you to think that they're gonna end up married, like all the fans want, and ruling the kingdom together, right? Like that's. Right. That was a big part of the fan rage, was just like, oh God, we wanted John and Danny to, you know, be controlling this thing together, and they just went absolutely against that. And yeah, it leads you to wonder what was the point of revealing that. Like it didn't lead to anything.
Yeah, especially because, you know, if that was common knowledge, if his you know, who he was common knowledge, then what he did to Danny at the end would have been 100% justified.
Yeah.
That was just him taking what is his.
Right, absolutely. And isn't that why he got sent away back to the wall? It's because he killed her?
I think it was because... Oh, yeah. But that was to appease Grey...
It was to appease Grey Worm.
Yeah. There was kind of a throwaway line with Tyrion or Sansa. I forget. One of them where they said that was kind of the, I guess, compromise they had to make was they won't execute him, but he's got to go to the wall.
I mean, I don't hate that, I guess. Like, there's consequences that he killed, you know, Daenerys. I don't know, whatever. they just wanted to get him back with the wildlings. Whatever.
Yeah. I don't know. That to me, that was, I think, one of my more disappointing moments, was because I was a really big Jon fan.
Sure.
And up until the season that they killed him, I think they really did a lot to make John fans. And then, you know, and I think I gave you this analogy before, was the episode with the pretzel war of The Simpsons.
Right.
Where there was the mob war at the end, and there was the little dude in the white suit that's just standing there, and Homer's like, he's going to do something. He's going to do something. That's what it was. That it was like, John, he's going to do something. He's going to do something. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. You know, he's going to take out Grey Worm. He's going to take him out.
Yeah.
Nope. And what the fuck was with Arya? The second to last episode. What? It's like they didn't give her any like script. They were just like, hey, Macy, just go on. Just do what feels right. And so she says, okay, well, I'm just going to wander around and then find a horse. And
why did she snuck into the city to go kill Cersei? Was that?
I think that's what the plan was.
Yeah. I actually didn't hate that. We're like freaking, God, what's his name? The Hound, where he's like, no, get out of here, girl. And
you're not like this. Yeah. No, you know what? That was, to me, that anything about the Hound, that episode was kind of was one of the high points, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Clegane Bowl, by the way, totally lived up to expectations. It was fantastic.
That was really good. That was actually.
The little moment building up to it when they're facing each other off and Thirsty just kind of sneaks past them. She's like, you know what? This doesn't have anything.
Yeah, that was outstanding. And he ends up, spoilers, I guess, obviously. He ends up throwing him through, like, the half-broken wall, and they die in fire, which is kind of like this weird poetic thing, of course.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's me that I'm hearing. I'm hearing myself, and I thought there was someone else in the room, but it's me that I'm hearing.
Okay, good. What do you think explains like the rage people had about this season? Like, there were definitely parts that I thought could have been better, but maybe I just didn't emotionally connect to it like these people did. So I didn't have this like, oh god, it's the worst thing ever kind of reaction. I thought it was like, yeah, it's fine. It could have been better, but it's good. Like what explains the vitriol that people have for it?
You know, I think a lot of it was how they what they did with Danny or Daenerys. I hate him. I think that was a lot of it. I think people expected her to be sort of like I was there too. I was a Daenerys fan. How could you not in the first few seasons?
Sure.
She went from the poor little, being raped and whatever to, but then as it went on, you kind of feel yourself like, well, I mean, it's good what she's doing, I guess, but I don't, for the first few seasons, actually, anytime there was anything in Essos, it was kind of, especially the middle seasons. No, go back to Westeros. I don't care. Were you kind of like that?
Completely. Yeah. 100%. Anytime it switched to Danny or Bran, I just sort of checked out and just let's get through it back to like the, give me back the drunken whoring dwarf. I want that guy back. Mm. Yeah.
Right. When it got interesting was the season. I don't remember what season it was, but with the Sons of the Harpy, that's when it got interesting. But then again, what was that?
Yeah, my memory's failing me, and there were at least like a season and a half that I missed.
It was just about the time Tyrion got hooked up with her. There was this group of, they had like these gold masks on, and they seemed like they were targeting Daenerys.
Mm-hmm.
And they were the ones that killed Barristan Selmy.
Oh, okay. Oh, right. Yeah.
And they were the ones too that it was just after Tyrion joined them. There was like this arena fight, and they came in and they killed everybody. But then Drogon came out and killed all of them. And that's when Drogon took her back to, I guess, Dothraki territory.
Right.
That was I can't remember what season that was. I want to say maybe the fourth or fifth.
I just want to throw out, we've got a fairly lively chat happening. I just want to say hi to my good childhood pal to this day that we only talk online, Jeff Peters.
Hey,
Jose Guzman, who's a good friend of mine who you don't know, Joey, and of course my good friend Harrison is here with us as well. Anyway, there's a lively debate happening in the chat, but in any case, what were your impressions of Danny kind of going bad? I'd rather hear yours before I give mine.
You know, I have no problem with a hero turning into a villain if it's done right. And, sure. I'll use it again as an example, Walter White.
and, the name of the show. The name of that show, Breaking Bad, means to, like, be a good person, but, like, do bad things. You know, it's like a Southern thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, but also, too, if you think about it in a certain way, kind of, even though he didn't go bad, he went from an adversary to but Hank in the last, I mean,
he certainly did some things that he wouldn't have thought he was capable of earlier.
But in the last season, when he's going up against Walter White, there, you know, when he knows, you know, he was kind of almost the villain of that season, right? Yeah. I mean, to a certain extent. So if it's done right, it's fine. I was fine with it.
Sure.
And like I said, it seemed like it was building toward it. I thought maybe at best, maybe she might get like an anti-hero status, but you know, the second to last episode with the siege on King's Landing, you know, as it's going on and on, I'm thinking, wow, you know, Cersei really wasn't that bad.
Yeah, it's like the lesser of two evils at that point, which is a totally George Martin thing to do, right? Like,
right.
Like he'll give you like Jamie pushing a child out of a window and crippling him, and then like switch it around to where like, oh no, like he's actually the good guy. Like he's done this kind of shit the entire story, and people are like shocked by it now.
Yeah. Right.
It was maybe my favorite part of the last season was her, you know, kind of quote unquote going bad, and everyone's calling it the heel turn, which I love because, as you know, I love pro wrestling, and that's a wrestling term. But I was so happy when this, you know, turned over into the mainstream. This idea of a heel turn, I thought her entire arc was executed beautifully. I had no arguments with it at all because she was still the exact same person throughout. You know, she still had all these same like hang-ups and all the same, as far as she was concerned, like burning that city was like part and parcel with everything else she'd ever done. Like we'd seen her burn people before that in her, you know, moral framework were awful and they deserved to die. Granted, the earlier ones, in our moral framework too, like the slavers and stuff, those are objectively awful, and so we can kind of sympathize with her more there. But then,
right,
like she sees her best friend beheaded in front of her, and like she just fucking snaps, and I loved it. It was my favorite part of the season, to be honest. And I know,
you know,
it pissed a whole lot of people off because they just wanted to love her throughout, but that's just not the material. Like, George Martin doesn't give you characters who you can just objectively love. That's...
Right. I think that might have been my favorite episode, actually. The one that ended with Miss Sandy getting...
Joe, you with me?
Yep.
Oh, there you are. Can you hear me? Yeah, there you are. Yeah, I lost you for a second. Go ahead.
Okay, I was going to say, I think that might have been my favorite episode of this season, that ended with her getting beheaded. Not that, you know, I like seeing her get beheaded, but to me, it kind of reminded me of that raw sort of you never know what you're going to get kind of thing from the first season.
Yep. Yeah, completely.
I also like how it started with the, and it's one of John's better moments, his eulogy for everybody that had died and how they kind of went on to every, you know, showed everybody. They showed the, you know, the little girl and it was, I thought that was just kind of, that was a great episode.
Yeah. Do you know, on Rotten Tomatoes, the one where, Danny like really goes crazy and is just like death from above, like carpet bombing King's Landing. That's the lowest rated episode in the show's history on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. That doesn't surprise me at all. Well, the whole season was kind of was like that, wasn't it? Didn't it just kind of get worse and worse and worse?
Yeah, I just before we did the stream, I was looking at a breakdown, and it was like 90 for the first episode, and then like 85, and then it cratered to like 50% favorable, and stayed about that for the last four.
So the first two were favorable.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much the consensus. Like, I randomly heard a 50-year-old man talking about it, and he was like in the straight up like nerd rage. You know, when I was just out in the world, and he was just like, "God, the first two episodes were amazing, and then they were just trash after that." It's like, yeah, I don't think they were that bad personally, but
I thought the first two episodes were kind of boring, actually.
Really?
You know, yeah, especially the first episode was just, oh, look at, here's, you know, John and Arya. Oh, here's Arya in the mountain. Here, you know, yeah. That's kind of all it was about, was the reunions and everybody's getting back to.
Can we just lump it all together under the umbrella term fan service?
Yeah, oh, totally.
Which I'm so fucking done with.
Yeah.
The nostalgia, God, especially in Star Wars, but in anything, like the nostalgia and the fan service, like the next Star Wars movie where they have the line, "I have a bad feeling about this," fuck you, I'm done. I'm never watching a Star Wars movie again. Stop it. It's so bad. It's just these moments that are just for like the geeks to like cheer at in the theater. I'm so done.
Yeah.
I'm so bored by it.
Right.
But
it does nothing to really increase anybody. I don't know. Overall, you know, like you said, it's a moment that people aren't going to, you know, although sometimes it works. Again, Endgame, that was a lot of that shit was that.
Yeah, you're playing with fire with me if you include too much of that stuff. But I realize that like I'm one movie ticket and there's a billion to sell if you just do all the fan service. So,
right.
I
totally agree.
It's just trash storytelling. I'm just so bored by it. It's like back when Star Wars came out, and there wasn't this whole like fucking religion built up around it, and it was just a little movie called Star Wars. Like, yeah, it got crappy reviews. It got like, I think famously like both Pauline Kael and Roger Ebert were kind of like, yeah, no, it's just some like dumb little like sci-fi fantasy movie. Like, it's just Flash Gordon. Don't waste your time. Things become iconic over time because like you give them the space to become iconic. You know, if fan culture now is like, oh, if it's not a callback to the earlier stuff, we don't want it. We don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a big problem. And like, they're kind of selling themselves short. Like, Last Jedi can't become iconic because people only want what's already been done. Like, they only want like the old shit. Yeah. Like, does that make sense?
Yeah. No, you know what? And like I said, for sometimes if it doesn't have you watched Better Call Saul at all?
I've seen a few episodes. I've heard from people who actually think it's better than Breaking Bad.
I would argue that it's possible. There's a lot of things, but one thing that they don't do, they'll give you a character every once in a while. You know, Mike's on it. He's a regular character.
Right.
They introduced Hector and the twins and Tuco, and they also even show how Hector wound up in the, is that his name? How he wound up in the
wheelchair.
So they have the wheelchair.
Yeah.
They have introduced a lot, but they haven't crammed it down our throats. It was all organic. Like I read it. There was an episode one time where they were in the hospital. I don't know if you remember, his brother, played by Michael McKean, had severe light sensitivity.
Right.
Psychotic issues. So he was in the hospital. And I remember reading that they thought that that might be a good way to bring in Marie. But they didn't, because it would have been so fucking forced. And so, you know, there is a way to do it. So it's not crammed down people's fucking throats.
Yeah, yeah. That would have just been for the fans to be like, oh, it's Marie. We know that character.
Exactly. Yeah.
Kind of like, and I hesitate to shit on the prequels too much these days because it's done to death, but kind of like in the prequels where it's just like, oh, it's C-3PO.
Right.
He's here for some reason, just because the fans wanted to see him.
Or with Chewbacca in the episode 3.
Perhaps the most glaring example. What started all this was somehow we got down this rabbit hole. We were talking about Danny turning evil, or Daenerys turning evil, if you will. I don't think you actually told me your thoughts.
I'm like you. I was fine with it. Like I said, I felt like they were building toward it. Mm-hmm. It didn't kind of have that. I think that it was missing a little bit of finesse. But and I think maybe Tyrion had a line where he mentions this. It's like we cheered for her when Cal Drogo put boiling gold on her brother's head, which,
right,
you know, as much as of an asshole he was, I think that if you really think about it, may have not been, you know, maybe a little bit of an overreaction, but we all cheered because, oh, he was mean to Danny. We cheered when she burned the bad guys. We, you know, all throughout, but then little by little, maybe it wasn't quite as black and white. And then even in season 7, when she burned the Tarleys, I think a lot of people were like, ooh, I don't know if I like that, you know?
Yeah.
But I think that that was, I think, honestly, I think that might have been the turning point. And that's even saying that with the fact that he was such an asshole to a character that we all love. But even still, we're like, I don't think that he needed to be burned alive with his son.
Right.
But, you know, and I think Tyrion had a line where, you know, we cheered for her, we cheered for her, we cheered for her. Well, you know, she just kind of thought that that was the norm, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. I completely bought the whole depiction of her. Like her moral code really just like kind of doesn't change. And it's just, it's who she's aiming her violence at that changes.
Right. And they said it over and over and over again that Targaryens are volatile. What's the line? Madness and greatness are two sides of the same coin. And every time a Targaryen is born, the world holds its breath.
Right, right. And they essentially flip that coin and see what happens. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that, and also, you know, there was always that potential that she was going to just turn into her father.
Yeah,
I don't think that was ever a secret or something that was just might happen. I think that was pretty well foreshadowed.
Yeah, it was always kind of sneaking around for sure.
Yeah,
the moment she got any taste of power, it was kind of there. I feel like.
Yeah.
So I have to ask, just because it's there, and you know I spend too much time on the internet. What do you think of the feminist critiques of the treatment of Daenerys specifically in this season? I saw a headline that was like, "How could they turn Daenerys into a psycho bitch ex girlfriend?" It's like, what?
That's a crazy oversimplification.
Yeah, she burned the city because like they executed her best friend and she kind of snapped and her family was always crazy. It had nothing to do with like a relationship or whatever.
Right.
I don't beg an answer from you, but I'm just curious what you think about those critiques.
No, that's the first time I've heard that. That's ridiculous.
Maybe we'll read it later, but. Yeah, I found it to be completely absurd. This season was roundly excoriated for being sexist, supposedly.
Really?
What's that?
That's ridiculous.
Well, shoot, no better time like the present. Maybe
I believe what you're saying. It's just that doesn't make any. I wonder why. What was some examples that they considered it to be sexist?
Screw it. Let's get into it. I'm very curious myself because I just saw the headline and laughed at it. So, sorry. Do you want me to send you the link so you can read along, or shall I just read?
I guess to your point,
Joey. Oh, there you are. Joey, hello? You there? Oh, there you are. We may have lost... He's coming and going, everybody.
Can you hear me?
There you are. And you're gone again.
Oh. Are you doing something?
There you are.
Oh. All right.
Oh, there Hello. You are.
All right.
You're with me. Okay.
I am. The third episode where you know when Arya kills the Night King.
Damn, you're cutting out again. I heard you say I heard you say the third episode when Arya kills, and then you cut out.
Yeah, kills the Night King.
Yes.
Okay, so I did read this. If you watch that moment again, John is at that moment. It keeps going back and forth. You know, the Night King right getting ready to kill Bran, and fighting I guess avoiding. Viseron, the zombified dread.
Right.
And at that moment, it looks like he's going to sacrifice himself, and he yells. Well, it sounds like what he's saying is, go. Like he's yelling, go!
Oh.
Which has, and this is to your point, so what it sounded like it was what he might have been doing is distracting Viseron. So Arya was able to do what she did.
Right.
Oh, which I like because it makes John seem not as fucking useless. but every time I would hear that theory and people talk about it, it was almost immediately dismissed saying, oh, so you mean the little girl can't do it on her own. She needs help from a big brother, huh? So you're not wrong.
So what we're talking about here is this headline is Game of Thrones baffling decision to turn Daenerys into a crazy, murderous ex-girlfriend. Let me see if I can just find a money quote here. Oh, the mother of dragons becoming a mad queen may work on paper with what the show has foreshadowed for seasons. All this talk of Targaryen's hereditary madness and her own streak of cruelty with their enemies, but her split-second decision to systematically murder half a city of innocent people does not. So, they explain why it works and then say it doesn't work. But it... Ugh.
Yeah. No, but...
Oh, here we go. This is good. In the 11th hour, Game of Thrones turned Dany not just into a mad queen, but into a crazy ex-girlfriend, the laziest of sexist tropes, and one that could have been so easily avoided. There were all the reasons in the world for Dany to snap, from genetics to bad fortune to isolation and betrayals. For the love of God, why make the final straw about Jon Snow? It wasn't. The final straw wasn't about Jon Snow.
No.
Am I crazy?
Not at all. No. That's
she was hearing the voices of all her relatives, right?
Right. And yeah, I mean just yeah, this is you want to talk about everything and every and maybe what it was is maybe she thought it was going to be more of a fight. And when she heard the bell, she's like, no, fuck you. I'm doing it.
Right, right.
But yeah, I don't get where that had anything to do with John.
That it had absolutely nothing to do with John. It had to do with her seeing Masande get beheaded, like the previous episode. And then she started hearing right. all like the voices of her relatives who were like the crazy ones or whatever. And yeah, she snapped. Yeah. It was not like an ex-boyfriend thing at all.
It was Masande. It was her second dragon. It was Jorah.
Yeah.
And I mean, up until even the very end, she still had nothing but affection to John, and vice versa.
Yeah, it was so stupid, dude. That's why I say, like, as a writer, like the worst thing that can happen to you is to get really, really popular.
Yeah,
because then you invite these idiots who are like, and it's such a weird thing to me, and I know you also, because like I support the goals of like feminism and anti-racism. Like, yeah, absolutely. Like, women should be paid exactly the same as men. Should have all the same rights. Fuck yeah. All of that stuff.
Yeah.
But they're so stupid online, dog. Like.
No, I know. And dismantling everything. There's sexism everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. It. I don't know. It's so weird to me. Like, I don't know when this started, where like every popular thing has to be like this, like, reflection of the culture. Like, I don't remember people saying about, like, Terminator. You know, that was really popular, and it had a girl protagonist, but people weren't like, oh, there's not enough black people in the movie. Whatever the fuck it is, I don't know. It's so weird to me.
But you know, the thing is, too, is it's also in reverse. Anytime there's a woman protagonist, there's also a reverse reaction, too. You know, for example, Ghostbusters, which, you know, whatever, you say what you will, but that hit negative before anybody saw any part of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
It's a fine line. It's like, I don't want to be part of that group either.
No, God, no, of course not. No, I don't want to be part of either of these groups.
Yeah.
I just want to like movies.
Right. Yeah, exactly. You know? And, you know, there's going to be women protagonists, and there's going to be male protagonists, and there's going to be white male protagonists, and there's going to be black protagonists.
Great.
It doesn't. Just watch the movie. Shut up and watch the movie.
Yeah. Can we just shut the fuck up about, you know, all the extra. I don't know. I have mixed feelings about it, because like I understand that like representation is an issue, and like, yeah, probably like black actors have been fucked over historically. I'm sure, I'm 100% sure that's true, but like, that doesn't mean every single popular thing has to like meet all this social criteria.
It has to check off every box, because it's not.
Right. Right. Exactly.
There's always going to be somebody left out, and if you run the risk of it being forced, then, you know, that's not good either.
Yeah, yeah. Well, my friend, I propose we're coming up on the hour mark. I say we take a 5-minute break and come back to this thing. What do you think?
Okay, sounds good to me. Do I need to do anything on my end?
No, but anything you say will be heard by the stream. So, you know, deal with that responsibility how you will.
You got it.
I'll play us a little music in the meantime, and I'll take five. I'll smoke if I got them, and we'll be back in a second.
Okay, you got it.
All right.
Outnumbered, was a lost cause all along. the weeds stand up all together, right or wrong. Ain't seen no reconstruction here. Scorched it all around. High school band played Dixieland.
Hello, Joey. Are you with me?
Yes. You hear me?
I can hear you just fine.
It
looks like my buddy Harrison may want to join us. Are you okay with that?
Of course.
All right. Let me sort this out. Please hold, everybody. Of course, we're live. I'm just gonna call him on Hangouts here. See if we can get him on. Gosh, that's probably loud. Hello, Brother Harrison.
Hello, sir.
Welcome. Brother Harrison, we are on with my my good pal, the great and powerful Joey Hernandez.
Hello. Ow. Hello, Harrison. Hello, sir. I'm glad I got my earbuds in so I can hear what you all are saying. Hello. All
right.
Hello, we're all here. Aren't
we? You're loud and clear.
Okay. Okay, good.
Okay.
All right. Well, we're back at this thing, everybody. Harrison, you have not watched the show, is that true?
I watched bits and pieces of it. I watched clips on YouTube, but I only watched one full episode in my life, and that was the That was the one episode where the red woman gave birth to that weird shadow monster thing that killed Stannis' younger brother.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. My friend and I, we had a free period in high school. He's like, yeah, I want to show you something. I'm like, what the hell is this?
Well, if you have anything to add, feel free to jump in. Well, this conversation will intersect lots of other things, so it won't be strictly Game of Thrones. But
okay,
Joey.
Yes.
My question for you: was there anything in the final season you absolutely hated?
It's kind of like what you were saying before, like having any strong feelings either way. You know what? I think that I hated Cersei's death. I think that was kind of a bummer.
Mm-hmm.
Not that she died. It just, how do you let a character like that? I don't know. What about you?
I think really the only thing I absolutely despised was the one scene that Sansa and Dany had.
You know what? Actually, anything with Sansa and Dany.
Yeah.
it was like this weird pissing contest, and
Yeah, it was very, very weird. Trying to add Harrison's picture to the stream as we speak here.
Oh, can people see me?
No, it would be an effort.
Okay, well, I'll just be a disembodied voice then.
Yeah,
ooh, I'm a ghost.
that's the theme of tonight anyway. I honestly don't even remember why I hated that scene so much now, talking to you. But at the time, I was laughing and it was a bad laugh. I was like, this is some of the worst writing I've seen from this show. But,
Are you talking about the scene that was in, it was like in a room, right? Like the map room or something like that?
Yeah. And I was possibly slightly inebriated when I was watching it, but it was just like, hey, Danny was like, hey, I love John. And Sansa was like, well, that's my brother or some shit. And like, I don't know. It was like if the feminists want to pick a fight with a show, like that'd be the scene I'd pick a fight with personally. But
yeah, protective younger sister, yeah,
right.
I will give Sophie Turner some credit though. I think that her character over the last few seasons has became 100 times more interesting, I think, than the beginning.
Very reflective of the source material, also. You know, she's sort of this like princess, like diva, you know, mean girl almost in book one, and really kind of right around the time of the marriage to Tyrion. No, even before that, the marriage to Joffrey, she becomes a lot more interesting and kind of, you know, I don't know, pragmatic and rational and just more interesting of a character as she matures, certainly.
She actually marries Joffrey in the book.
Oh,
I don't think she does. I skimmed through that one chapter, and I don't think they did. I could be wrong, though.
No, I think you're probably right. That's me being sloppy. No, isn't it? Yeah, no, you're right. He does get rid of her before that. That's they do depict it in the show.
But I remember when I skimmed the book, Joffrey said that he was going to keep her around for his entertainments. I don't know what that was implying.
Yeah.
Whether or not he was going to be like forcing himself on her or just beating her.
Right. She does marry Tyrion for sure, but yeah, no, she doesn't actually marry Joffrey. That's true.
Okay.
The wedding made him hell right there.
I haven't read a page, not one page of that book, so.
Well, yeah, I wanted to get to that too in a second, but the only other thing that I really hated was Sam having a book called like The Song of Ice and Fire or whatever.
Oh my God, that was so
too much like Lord of the Rings for you guys.
Yes, and I know Harrison, you're a big Tolkien guy.
Yes, Tolkien forever.
I found that so despicable and so cheesy.
Yeah, well, actually. now that you bring that up, I kind of think George R. R. Martin is, well, he's just a cheap Tolkien knockoff, because yeah, I think he did add the two R's in his name just to be more like Tolkien, sound more like him. And also, I think he's just like, oh, I'm gonna be the dark and edgy Tolkien.
That, well, we'll get to that perhaps in a minute, but I don't know, Joey, your thoughts on that scene, sir?
On the Sam scene?
The scene with Sam, with the here's game of what is it? What was it? Ice and fire.
Yes.
Yeah. That was dumb.
Well, they got that book written very quickly. The Game of Thrones has only been ended for what, at a few weeks at that point.
Yeah.
And that book looks to be about what, 12 inches thick.
Yeah, kicked it out quick. Right.
Yeah, like I would kill for the ability to write that many pages in a week.
Yeah.
and the irony is George R. R. Martin, you know, completely opposite. Maybe that was.
Yeah. How long has it been since he published the last book? What was it been? 2011?
Ish, something like that. What's that, Joey?
No, I didn't say anything.
He's never gonna finish those books. I feel it in my bones. Like, why would he bother at this point, right?
Yeah, he's going to drop dead, and next thing we know, like, for a full month straight, the internet is going to be ablaze about, like, oh, we're never going to know how the series should really gonna end, and
yeah.
We're only going to be stuck with the HBO bad end. Oh, the humanity, oh, the sadness.
Even though they have his outline, so it's probably exactly what he wanted to do.
You know what would have been pimp if he would have dropped it the day before the final episode premiered?
Hell yes.
All right, so here's the choice. You either read how it ended or watch how it ended.
Yeah. The guy that played Barristan actually came out and said that there's this big conspiracy that he's had him done for years, but they asked him to postpone it for the show. he said that was nonsense, to be fair. So I don't know, but...
Martin said that, or yeah,
George said that. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But yes, Jose coming in with he says Dance with Dragons was on was published 2011. So yes, that's true.
I was having a debate with Mr. Jose in the comments section about, and we have agreed that if you get into an argument with someone, all you have to say is, "I have a dragon on my command, sir. Your argument is invalid. Otherwise, I'll just pull a Danny on you."
That's right. fellas,
how did the book end? Where is it? Where are you guys? Well, for the book readers, where are you?
God, I have no fucking idea. I read it and I don't remember.
Must not have been that good then.
I'd say probably the end of season six would be my guess.
Where John is ambushed.
I think maybe he...
For some reason, I think I remember hearing that somewhere.
Maybe he dies in the end, actually. Yeah, that kind of vaguely rings a bell. Yeah, but as you said, it's been years. So the show is certainly taking precedence. So yeah, I have very little memory of it. But
yeah.
Speaking of the books, I'd like to know when you gentlemen first became aware of this story, because I
first became aware of the Game of Thrones books right when the trailers for season one started dropping. I'm like, what is this thing supposed to be? Okay, it's got Boromir in it, so maybe that could be cool.
Yeah, that's probably the same for a lot of people. Joey, what about you? What?
The summer that season one came out, there was a couple other kind of period shows around the same. There was a I don't know if you remember. There was a I think it was on Showtime. There was a season long version of like Camelot. Did you ever see that? It was with Eva Green and.
Yes, I've heard they. I've seen like little snippets of that show, but never a whole episode.
I myself am unfamiliar.
Joseph Fiennes plays Merlin.
Oh.
And then also the Borgias. came out about the same time with Jeremy Irons.
Yeah.
And I remember they came out before, and I really liked them, but I remember hearing, you know, these are okay, but, you know, at least they'll tide us over until Game of Thrones comes out. And that was the first time I heard of Game of Thrones. And I remember, you know, I saw the trailer and it looked awesome, but I had never heard of the books before that.
So this will be relevant to you, Joey. Also to you, Harrison, but less so because it's personal with me and Joey. I first heard of these books when a mutual friend of ours, that would be one Paul, Santa Rosa Paul, was in fact reading a Game of Thrones in the lawn area of Kent State, or Kent Hall on not Kent State, that's a different place. That's where all those college students got murdered, everybody. No, at Kent Hall in Santa Rosa Junior College.
No shit. That's yeah. That's
this about college students being killed?
No.
I'm a bit divorced from the news lately, so I'm not up to date on all world affairs.
No, we lived in a place called Kent Hall on a college campus, and I called it Kent State, which is a place where famously in the 70s at a Vietnam War protest, several college students were shot by police.
Okay.
Funny joke, everyone. Funny story. Anyway, okay. Yes.
Morbid, but okay.
Our friend Paul was the first person to ever actually introduce me to this story, and he
That's crazy.
What's that?
That's crazy. So we're talking 2001.
Yes. Yeah, the first book came out in like 95, 96, something like that.
I can't believe that. That's wild.
Our friend Jose is hoping to join us. Let me just give me 1 second to DM me.
I look forward to continuing my argument with him. We'll keep it civil, I promise.
But
we won't unleash the dragons.
Well, I appreciate that. We're having a conversation here, buddy. But yes, he at the time put over and very much highlighted the gray morality of the story, which is also kind of what attracted me to it initially, I would say. Although I didn't actually start reading it until, you know, 10 years later, I on a writing group, everybody was obsessed with it. They're like, "Oh God, oh this Song of Ice and Fire, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God," right. And they all talked about how, you know, it's not kind of a very typical fantasy story, which tends to have very, you know, bifurcated morality. You know who the good guys are, you know who the bad guys are. You know that's not this story at all. And that's certainly kind of what attracted me to it as a fan of fantasy fiction. You know, that was original and interesting. But Joey, correct me if I'm wrong, you're really not a fantasy fan. Like, this is...
No, I think I am. More so than I used to be, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, especially like this sort of... I mean, I know it's not a time period, but medieval sort of... that ish, you know, castles and jousting, yeah. You know, it's, I've gotten a lot more into it than over the years than I used to. That's partially because my wife drags me to Renaissance fair.
Oh, really? But do you dress up for it and go in full costume?
I wish everything I want to dress as, my wife always knocks it down. I want to go as a Jedi. I think that'd be really funny, but you know, my wife.
I'd go as a Viking.
Go to one of those things and take a shot every time you see one of those Hands of the King pins, and you'll be fucking waiting.
Hey, whoa. You get alcohol blood poisoning pretty quickly.
Yeah. Also, you know, cleavage as far as you can see, but whatever.
Yes, those push-up bras are a wonderful piece of technology.
Oh dear, let's try to keep this curated for the kiddos in the chat or whatever.
Joey, what is the last Ren fair you went to?
Probably last year. They have one every year over here, but we didn't make it this year. We went last year though.
And how was that?
It's always fun. Just food, you know, and the people that do cosplay, it's fun to watch, and people are in character, and it's fun. Now that we have our son, we don't have that much freedom, but you sure. know, it's a time for sure.
I'd
recommend it at least once for anybody.
I haven't been since about 1996. I went with Sean Bowles and his father, and it was a hell of a time. There were ladies and battles and
yeah,
crazy shit happening all around me.
Yeah, I went, you know.
Go ahead, Ben.
It's a time.
I remember when I was a kid, my parents took me to a cowboy fair. And there was this mechanical cow that you got to lasso as it went on along the track. And I remember I got very muddy at the end of it. And then my high school class and I went to the same fair years later, and I kid you not, I spent the whole day looking for this one thing because I wanted to do it, and I could not find it. But just as we were leaving, I looked to my right, and right there by the entrance was the darn thing. I'd walked right past and I hadn't seen it. And then I also went to a medieval fair also when I was a kid, and my parents, siblings and I got to break down a castle door with a quote unquote battering ram. That was pretty fun.
Nice.
Yeah. That's cool. I haven't been to, and that was an outdoor thing. No.
Joey, sure. I'm curious. Well, I'm curious as to both your thoughts on this, but in particular, Joey, because I know you're a big fan. All the actors being crybabies about the backlash on social media, where they're like, I don't know. You got Jon Snow out there going, "We all worked really hard on this. We've poured our heart and soul into this. Fuck you if you're criticizing us." And
well, they do put a lot of hard work into those productions. I mean, how what's the budget for Game of Thrones? Something like $100 million.
It's the biggest TV show of all time.
I mean, it's not as big as Amazon's Lord of the Rings TV series is going to be. What's that? $1 billion budget?
Right. Yeah. Ish. But yeah, well, I don't know. What do you think about the actors being crybabies? Basically,
you know, I sympathize. It's got to be tough, you know. People don't. I think take into consideration when you do something and you put a lot of work into it and you feel really good about it and people shit all over it and on a massive scale, it's got to get to you. However, I will say though that if you watch some videos, and there's a lot of videos with cast reactions before, they knew it was shit, or they knew that it was going to be they knew it was going to be polarized. So it's a little bit strange to me that, to a certain extent, I do agree with you, Kevin, that they got that upset about it, but yeah. I get it. It's got to be a bummer.
Yeah, but that's been the case throughout history, right? Like, the fact that you put a lot of work into something doesn't mean people don't have a right to shit on it.
Yeah, that's true.
Like,
yeah,
you put okay, people work just as hard on like Tarzan and the Ape People as they did on Citizen Kane, right? Like, right. It takes just as much work to make a good thing as it does to make a bad thing. Like, this is what you signed up for. So, right. Like, all this, like, social media, like, crying, it just rings a little hollow to me. I completely realize I sound like that old guy that is like, oh, everyone gets a participation trophy now. But it's like, how do I not see it that way? They're all just, like, crying. I mean, it's like, oh, we worked so hard on it. Well, it's like, no, fuck you. Who cares? Either it's good or it's not.
Actually, didn't he actually check himself into rehab?
He did, yeah. Well, that may have been for booze also. I don't know.
Maybe the booze was because people didn't like like Game of Thrones. It's... You know what, and when all is said and done, though, what this has kind of left me with, well, you know, like we've said a couple times, that we really, I don't think that we really had a strong opinion either way. But I will say, yeah, though, that, like, the prequel series, zero interest. Like, zero.
I mean, I shouldn't be that surprised that that's happening, but, yeah, of course it's happening. It's... fucking goldmine. Jose, hello? Are you there? I think you're probably muted. Harrison, I think you may also be muted as well. Okay. Slight technical difficulties. Everyone appears to be muted.
Can you hear me?
Hello?
Hello? Can you hear me too?
I can hear you.
Okay.
Harrison, I've lost you. Jose, you're in the call, but I can't hear anything you're saying. Yeah. All the crying on social media just felt to me like... kind of like part and parcel of the modern era, just too much access to people. It's like, yeah. Do you think like Humphrey Bogart ever cried when somebody was like, oh dude, the Maltese fucking sucked? Like, do you really think Humphrey Bogart was just like up in their face like, look bitch, I worked really hard on this?
Like, no, well, you gotta remember too though, he wasn't getting it on the same scale that some of these guys are getting it.
Fair, completely fair.
Or who was it that Tony Soprano always used to reference? Gary Cooper?
Yeah.
He would always reference Gary Cooper. You know, maybe Gary Cooper would have been a whiny little bitch too if he had Instagram.
So social media, as you've obviously realized in your life, is a big part of the problem.
Oh, yeah. Totally. I mean, in so many ways. Everybody's got a fucking opinion. You know what I always like about social media? This is kind of a tangent, but so when because I follow a few, like, more, like for example, my local news, the LA NBC station, right? Now, right. They'll put on an article that or a news story that is kind of maybe a puff, you know, just kind of nothing kind of thing, you know, but just whatever, it's news. And right. You go through the comments, and there's inevitably going to be somebody or more than one person that goes, oh, this is news? This isn't interesting. Then why are you fucking commenting? Just move on. And I think that's ultimately the problem is too many people want to say, I don't like it.
Right.
I don't.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like Yelp, it's the same thing. Like, I really give a shit what your opinion, what a suburban mom's opinion is on fucking AutoZone, you know?
I troll Yelp sometimes by, like, going on to, like, some chain restaurant I visit, like, the Denny's in, you know, Fresno, California, and giving it, like, a 5-star, like, glowing gourmet review or something, you know what I mean? Yeah, it's, it's the everybody's a critic culture.
Yeah.
You know.
Everybody's got their own podcast. Oh, no.
Right. Well, yeah. And here we are, you know, being hypocrites, I suppose. But, yeah, no, it's really weird. Like, there's this NBA player, Kevin Durant, who's probably the consensus best player in the world right now. You know, there's a little argument there, but he's top three at least. But he's always going on Twitter on like these like fake sock puppet accounts and like going after his trolls, you know, like some random like Dick Cheese 6969 says, oh, Kevin Durant sucks, he's a fag, and like he goes on these fake sock puppet accounts and like responds to these people. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, it's internet culture. You can't engage with this kind of thing.
Yeah.
If you engage with it, you lose.
Right.
No.
Like what? Like noob 6969.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
The well, 69 is on here. Call me a dickhead again.
You're... It's like you're the best basketball player in the world. Why do you care?
Yeah.
Like, you've been a part of the biggest TV show in the world. Why do you care?
Right.
You got to... Do you have time for a brief intermission?
No. Yeah, I mean, yeah, sure.
Okay, so if I kick us offline for just a second, I'm going to try to help Jose and Harrison through their audio issues so they can jump on and, you know, join the chat.
Okay.
All right. Give me like 5 to 10 maximum.
Okay.
All right, everybody. We'll be right back.
Hey buddy, are you back? Hello? Hello? Can you hear me? Yeah. No, it's fine. Yeah, I got a little bit more. I'm gonna eat a little bit though. I'm eating my dinner though. I know. No, I know.
I am a renegade.
Hello? Yeah. Hello? Number 3 on here on my icon. Hello?
Hello?
Mr. Jose, is that you joining this little group of ours? I thought I could hear him for a second there.
That was me.
Oh, yeah, I can hear you. Historian. Sorry, and I can hear him. Can you hear me? Okay, good. You see, we could hear you two fine. We could hear you and the other guy fine, but you couldn't hear us at all. That's very strange. It's on HWR, and I cannot read speak today. Is that a world renowned historian live stream without a few tech problems?
Well, I went on with the waitress.
Okay.
How was I to know she was with the Russians too? Ha!
It's the first time I've ever crashed a live stream.
I was gambling in Havana.
I find working with computers sometimes is, I think pulling teeth is preferable. Mr. Jose, are you receiving this transmission?
Hey, Kevin. Oh my goodness, finally. No, that's all, you know, you would think with the advances in technology, you'd be able to get this stuff figured out.
Yeah. The technology may advance, sir, but sadly, we do not.
Right? Exactly. Oh, so glad to be finally connected to this damn
thing. All right, boys, we're back. Can I get a quick sound off just to make sure you're all here?
This is Harrison MacArthur, Draco Pendragon, sounding out.
This is Jose. Your dragons are valid here.
Joey, you still with us?
Yep, here I am.
Hey! Holy cow.
Oh, we did it!
Huzzah! Victory over technology! Take that, Skynet!
You know what? I'm never using Google Hangouts. All about the Discord life. Discord, you have my strength and approval.
I blame myself, boys. If you stuck with us through that disaster, sorry about that. I am a boomer. I've made no bones about that.
We're all boomers, boys.
Getting back to the material at hand. What did we think of the end of Cersei and Jaime? Because lots of people were angry about that.
I liked it. I liked watching them being crushed to death in, I guess you could say, being crushed, being destroyed by their own ambitions for power, because the seat of power itself just landed on them. Although, personally, I would prefer that they had played the original, like, Alanistar always pays his debts over that scene. I actually re-edited it on my computer to do that.
That was kind of Cersei paying her debts in a lot of ways. Like,
I really wish Jaime had ended up shanking her, like, just Valonqar prophecy.
Oh, stop it. Joey, what'd you think of Jaime and Cersei's final scene?
I don't know. It was fine.
Yeah.
I think we talked about earlier. Jaime was fine. That was fine. I would have liked a little more fanfare with Cersei, I think. That little boy in the first episode of the season got a better death than Cersei. I thought that was a little weird.
What little boy? Who are you doing?
The little boy that got snatched by the White Walkers and.
You mean the one that they found him like shish kebab to the wall and he comes back to life and Tormund burns him to death?
Yes.
Yeah. Like,
that was crazy.
Like, all of the kids' death more interesting than Cersei's. I don't know.
Because Cersei wasn't killed by an eye zombie. Although that would have been rather entertaining had she been killed. Like, can you imagine if the Battle for Winterfell had failed and the army just swipes down north? Like, Cersei's looking at the like the cold fronts coming towards her and going, crap, I think I should leave. Euron, is that trip to the Iron Islands still available?
Oh, that whole battle episode is a disaster.
Yeah, can't see anything. It's like I'm viewing the battle through a potato.
Right, no, it's horrid.
I thought it was perfect. I don't know what you guys are talking about.
Perfect. There were a few bits in it that were rather entertaining. Dragon fire, anyone?
Just briefly to finish up.
Very quiet all of a sudden.
Just to finish up Cersei and Jaime, I thought there was a poetry to it of dropping like the focus of her, like whole power, okay, like the focus of all her power. Like,
I can hear you.
Dropped it on her.
Well, hey, Kevin, I actually wanted to bring a point about that whole Jaime and Cersei death thing, because I don't think Cersei is necessarily the problem.
Explain.
Okay, so I don't think that Cersei is necessarily the problem in terms of the death. I think it's the Jaime Lannister reuniting with her again is the problem. Because you look at Jaime Lannister and you've had it where... he hooks up with Brienne of Tarth to make her lose her virginity. And you see all this development.
Harrison, we can hear you. We got you.
Yeah, there we go, Harrison. And you see all this development. I would say the best relationship scenes where I feel like the relationship breaks down is during when he fights, with Bronn on his side. And they're facing Daenerys and he sees... the capability of Daenerys, and he tries to warn Cersei, and Cersei's like, no, you're wrong. You don't know anything. And it's like, at that point is where I see the relationship deteriorating. I don't see it making actually any sense for him to just go back to Cersei and be like, oh, I want to die with Cersei. At all.
Yeah, I get that. I don't know. Joey, thoughts about that?
I get that, but I don't think it was... I don't know that it was his intention to be with Cersei. I think it was more him trying to stop the dogs of war by, you know, ringing the bell and everything. I don't know necessarily that his intention was to rush into her arms, but I don't. But then again, he did. That's what he said.
I was gonna say it reminds me of the scene where he's talking to Bronn. And Bronn asks him, how do you want to die? And he says, you know, in the arms of the woman I love. And it was like that weird foreshadow going forward.
You're typing.
Or what was it too? It was when he went back to when he was in River Run, and he was talking to, I can't remember if it was Edmure.
No, or I can't hear you guys at all.
The Blackfish, where he mentions about how.
Okay, so you guys can hear me. I just can't hear any what you guys say. Oh, hello. Someone's turned the things on.
No, that guy looks like me.
How do I do that? I'm trying to mute all of you guys.
That's fantastic.
Can we all hear Harrison?
I can hear Harrison just fine.
Okay.
Okay.
I feel like Harrison just like staring into my soul and searching.
Apparently, he's muted us.
You can hear me fine.
Yes, we can all hear you fine.
I can't hear you.
Yeah, exactly. It's funny because we're like having this conversation, all of a sudden he's like, "Hey, guys,
can you hear me?" Oh man. But anyways, I think at least for me, while Harrison tries to get to figure it out, I don't have a problem with the way Cersei died. I mean, she should have died maybe a better death, I feel like, but whatever. I have a problem with this Jaime going back to her, and if that wasn't the intention of the writers. Well, then they really screwed up.
Yeah, but why, though? How? Like, why is that a problem?
What? Oh, Jaime?
Yeah.
Because he had already established himself, in my opinion, based on his growth through the seasons, that he was slowly going away from Cersei. So for him to just kind of be like in one episode abruptly, be like, I must go to Cersei's arms, I don't buy that.
But
whatsoever.
But like Joey was just saying, like that wasn't it. He was trying to like stop this horrible like catastrophe from happening, like call off dogs of war. In Joey's words.
Well, then I buy that.
Before he left, he kind of gave her the "I am what I am" thing.
And that was one of the dialogue scenes that I also had a problem with too. Is after he's like, "I am what I am," and it's like that's not what your character has been. What are you doing?
But I think just in general, there were tons of story arcs that they just threw out completely out the window. I'm like Kevin, I was okay with it, but I agree with you too that it was why go through the pain of this fantastic story arc only to just put him right back at the beginning. They might have just showed up at the last frame and tossed Bran out the window again.
Absolutely. It's like it's like the whole secret Targaryen storyline with Jon Snow. Why even bring it up if you're going to leave it the way they left it?
Yeah.
Because if I'm Jon Snow and I'm actually a Targaryen.
I still can't hear anything. I can't hear you guys at all.
We can hear you great. Like
we can hear you.
Like you're contributing.
Anyways, oh, I love it. I feel like that was me. I feel like that where he's at, that's where I was a few minutes ago. Just screaming at Kevin, like, Kevin, I can hear you.
So I'm fellas, carry on amongst yourselves. I'm going to kick Harrison
Technology
and invite him back.
Curse you.
Okay.
Why must you stab me in the back?
Alrighty.
talk amongst yourselves, boys.
Computer, okay, not a problem.
Two.
Right.
At two.
But I think we're pretty much on the same page, though.
Can I just leave the chat and we'll try this again?
I'm giving Harrison thumbs.
He's trying to get Harrison back invited.
This is one for the blooper reels.
Right. Hey, Joey, I do have something that I was going to say with the whole secret
target
in mind. Like, why bother bringing it up and then not using it to an advantage? Is this just HBO being HBO?
I think a part of it is and I'm not 100% sure if this was in the book, but I wonder if it was just the writers kept on reading the fan theories and they're like, all right, let's do it. But they had no...
That worked. Can you guys hear me?
We can hear you great.
Yes. We can hear you.
Jump off the thing and get back on.
That was
right. The most important thing is, can you hear us?
I can hear you. Yes.
That was so awesome when we could hear everything you were saying and you couldn't hear anything we were saying.
No, damn. I didn't say anything compromising.
Anything risque.
No. I'm glad I didn't start growling about, this must be their fault. They must be muted. Joe, this is helping my self-esteem levels.
Joey, you were saying?
Where were we?
We're discussing the Secret Targaryen arc and how HBO dropped the ball on that.
Yeah. I think it was just something that they may have read and they thought, oh, it sounded good, but then didn't really. Because like I was telling Kevin before, I mean, if he is in fact Targaryen and rightful heir to the throne, then him playing Dany was more duty than anything, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I agree with that. Well, and if I'm a Targaryen, I'm not going to be exiled by some wheelchair-bearing guy named Bran Stark. I have more right to the Iron Throne than you do.
Bran is broken.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that's what I have a problem with. It's just like, they banish him off again to the Night's Watch, where obviously I think they're alluding that he becomes the king beyond the wall again. But he's a Targaryen in the most technical term. You're telling me he just can't, he has no claim over anything, and the lords are just going to be like, yes, we're going to listen to this person in a wheelchair. Yes, because that makes sense.
Well, I think a lot of that has like this idea of like, the person who should be president shouldn't want it. Like, wasn't that like a Kurt Vonnegut saying? He was like, anyone who wants to be president shouldn't be. So therefore, like, give it to this person who doesn't want it and will be this, like, kind of righteous dictator, right?
He didn't want it. Yeah, something very similar happens in the Narnia books with, I think, Prince Caspian. Has anyone here read the books?
Yes, read those in my childhood. I'm still a child.
I saw that movie.
Yeah, but there's a scene where Prince Caspian is standing before the lion Aslan, and the lion says, "You are to be king." And Caspian says, "I do not think I am ready to be king." And Aslan replies, "It is for that very reason I know you are ready to be king."
Right. Right, exactly. Right. So therefore, you give it to the wheelchair psychic kid.
Yeah, but how many people in Westeros knows that Bran is practically their version of the internet?
Everybody knows though that his dick doesn't work thanks to Sansa.
Oh.
I don't can we keep this G-rated, thank you.
He volunteered that information for absolutely no reason.
No, it's okay. Hey, I say, Joey, here, we'll keep it G-rated.
That's a misconception. People who are paralyzed actually can have kids, at least I'm fairly certain.
I saw an episode of Rescue Me where Michael J. Fox is in a wheelchair, and he apparently, his character also gets like random hard erections at any moment, and he's just like, I guess, like super peeing.
Well, that's the thing. I didn't know that I learned today.
I'm grateful that my microphone's cutting out every now and then, so I can't hear what you're saying. I don't need this image in my head.
Hey, we're talking. I'll say it's Game of Thrones that put that in our images. My goodness, they basically said that nudity is perfectly okay more than any other show on cable television.
Jose, you're pretty muffled.
Yeah.
Hello.
Oh, how about now?
That's much better.
Okay, we can hear you. I can hear you at least.
Okay. No, what I was saying was that HBO has basically, they are going to be the bar limit for how much nudity and violence you can show on a show from now on.
I mean, I don't know if it'll be the limit.
The last few seasons, though.
What? I'm sorry, Joey. One more time.
I don't think the nudity was as prevalent the last few seasons, though.
Definitely not. Yeah, they scaled that way back. Big time.
I wouldn't know.
That's because, you know, women have rights, too. I mean,
well,
if you're Daenerys, if you're Emilia Clarke, there's a point in time where I would get tired of the nudity, you know, and I would just be like, I don't want to be typecasted like this. So I totally understand where she was coming.
That's why she wouldn't do 50 Shades. She was originally supposed to be 50 Shades.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, no,
that's interesting.
Yeah. And I don't blame her.
And second,
it was supposed to be her and Charlie Hunnam.
Well, fellas, that in fact speaks to two questions I actually had about this material. Number one, I guess we'll just go in order. Number one, who do you think out of this cast is going to have the best post Game of Thrones career?
Oh, that's
feel free in any order you like.
I would say Sophie Turner, hands down.
After X-Men now?
What's that?
You think after this last X-Men, though?
Which fucking flopped.
That wasn't her fault, though. That was legitimately not her fault.
That is true. That was studio infighting and people trying to rewrite the script on the fly.
Yeah, no, I mean, I see what you're saying.
Don't get me wrong. Yeah, no, but her image is on everything. She is going to be associated with that movie, no matter what.
Yeah,
that's true.
Because she's Jean Grey, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's Jean Grey, Sansa Stark, Queen of the North.
Also, Boy George, apparently. She's going to be Boy George in a movie.
Who?
Oh, God.
Forgive my ignorance. Who is this individual?
A musician from the 1980s, Harrison, before you were born, sir.
Go 90s.
Harrison, how old are you?
I'm 25. How old are you?
Oh, same. I'm the same. 93. I'm 25 years old.
Yes, so before you gentlemen 16. Were born... There was a musician called Boy George. He was in something called the E Street Band, I think. It was Boy George and the E Street Band.
Hey, whoa, back up. But Sansa, but Sophie's going to be playing him?
Google him, dude.
I don't think it wants you.
Dude, she kind of looks like him. I'm sorry. She does.
Did you ever see The Wedding Singer?
Say again?
Did you ever see The Wedding Singer?
No, I watch older movies as historian could attest to.
Bridge on the River Kwai and shit.
Bridge on the River Kwai, The Bridge Too Far, The Lord of the Rings. Yeah, I think like show me any movie from 1930 between 1930 and 1960, I could probably tell you everything about it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Wedding Singer was the late 90s.
Okay.
And
Adam Sandler romp, but there's a character that was very much modeled after Boy George.
And oh, interesting.
So Sophie Turner absolutely looks like Boy George. I'm sorry.
Oh,
it's true.
That's fine. It's okay.
I see.
Do you think Lena Headey is going to be typecast as the villain from now on because of Cersei?
The last non Game of Thrones thing I saw her in was the Judge Dredd remake, which was awesome.
What about the Sarah Connor Chronicles?
Was Lena Headey in that?
I'm almost positive. Yeah, no one remembers the Sarah Connor Chronicles.
Yeah,
I saw her in
Brian Austin Green.
Yeah,
I saw her in 300, both 300s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was Gorgo, right?
She was in the first Purge.
First Purge movie?
The first Purge, yeah.
Oh, that's true. She was Ethan Hawke's wife.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know that. I stay away from The Purge like the plague.
Oh, I love The Purge.
What is the point of those movies? Like 24 hours, all crime is legal? That is a horrible
future of our country.
My friend, cautionary tale. Another couple
future
of
our country.
Yeah.
There's cautionary tales, and then there's just pure, what the heck am I watching? Kind of.
I mean, we could get there at some point.
I doubt it. I mean,
maybe a couple more. The first one was really good.
Yeah, the first one is good. The rest of them are
the prequel, that was pretty good, too.
Joey, you cut out a little bit. You said the prequel was good?
I just watched the prequel. That one was pretty good, too.
Huh.
That one was all right, yeah.
The prequel for The Purge, okay. When you said the prequel, I instantly thought Star Wars, but that's just how my mind works.
it's like a... like a experimental where they just do it on Staten Island to see how it works.
Right, right.
Very political. Very political.
Joey, remember when we went to Halloween Horror Nights and they had an actor there playing like the villain from the first one, and he looked so much like him, we thought it was the actual dude?
Yeah, seriously.
That was crazy.
That was the stuff, man. That was awesome. Going back to your original question, Kevin, I think Peter Dinklage is going to see the most fruit from this.
Oh, yes. That's a given.
So
that man can act.
Let's say elephant in the room. Yes, he's a great actor. Yes, he looks like an actor. But yes, he's also 4 feet tall. And yes, that does limit your options and opportunities in Hollywood, or at least it has until, you know, this generation. Maybe they'll create roles for him. I don't know. But nothing against the guy. He's amazing. But isn't that like a barrier?
You know, Kevin, I had that same thought as well with Peter Dinklage, but I remember him from when I first saw him on the show Nip Tuck. And I thought that he was always going to be casted as like the dwarf character. And then Game of Thrones only obviously proved that theory. But I think going forward, he's going to get more work solely because of the role that he took over in that. And he just redefined it as the character.
Yeah.
Apparently, Tyrion is a lot more agile. Isn't he described as like backflipping off of a second story roof right in front of Jon?
He's a lot darker in the books.
He's certainly a lot uglier. Like Peter Dinklage is like let's just say it. Like Peter Dinklage is a handsome dude. Like in the books, like Tyrion's
handsome,
like,
man.
He's got like a bowl cut of awful blonde hair, and he's got like grotesque features and shit. And he's like, when he gets
match, right?
Yeah. And when he gets wounded in that the one of the big battles, and it actually like fucks him up. Like it makes him look like Skeletor or something.
It happens.
Yeah, it's the Battle of Blackwater Bay.
I see why they didn't do that for the show, but.
Yeah, I don't think Peter Dinklage would have liked having to wear prosthetics for the rest of the series.
Well, they make much more an emphasis in the book of those grotesque features, and then like we obviously see in the show that he is obviously a womanizer and he's able to go to whorehouses and get his way. That's the one thing that they separate, that Martin makes a big point in the books, is that the reason he's able to do that is because A, he's a Lannister, and B, because he's got a giant, you know. It has nothing to do with his looks. It's the fact that he can persuade himself into those rooms, because if he was any other, like a commoner, the whorehouses would not allow him to be in there, essentially, is what Martin made the point of.
Joey, your thoughts on Peter Dinklage's future career?
Well, I mean, he's got that, he played, what's his name? The guy from Fantasy Island. Has that already been out yet? The
Hervé Villechaize?
He played Tattoo?
Yeah.
No, that's news to me. That sounds incredible.
I have no idea what this is. Fantasy Island?
You've never heard of Fantasy Island?
Do you play in Moss?
I live under a rock, okay?
I'll send you some links. But anyway, I haven't heard of that, but it sounds incredible.
Yeah, from what I heard, it's amazing. Also, hey, Kevin, did you know that Peter Dinklage was in an episode of Seinfeld?
I did not know that.
Okay, do you remember the episode where Elaine has a relationship with her wake-up call guy?
Yes, vaguely, yes.
And he's the wake-up call guy on the phone, but then they hired a regular-size actor to play him when she actually meets him.
Oh, my God.
But it's his voice on the phone.
Wow.
Peter Dinklage, we're talking back like mid-90s.
The first time the first time I thought I saw him was in Elf with Will Ferrell.
Yeah.
In like 2010.
I hate that movie with a burning passion.
That is him. That is him. He's the executive elf.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I hate Elf. I hate the movie Elf so much. I probably destroyed my credibility with you guys, but I hate that movie so much.
Dude, Elf was great.
Elf was not great. How dare you?
It's a classic, man.
My best friend forces me to watch it every flipping Christmas, and I always reply with, "Bah humbug, I'm not watching it."
I hate Elf so much.
Thank you, someone else knows my pain.
Joey, are you like these dum-dums, or do you like Elf?
No, I like
dum-dums.
That's Mr. Dum-Dum to you. And by the way, you don't have dragons. Your arguments are invalid.
Yes, Jose and I have dragons. Your arguments are invalid.
Oh, my God.
Oh, harmless Christmas movie. Zoe Deschanel, come on.
Hey, Joey, I have a follow-up question, actually, on what you're saying about Peter Dinklage. Do you think he'll go back to theater? I feel like I've noticed a trend recently where a lot of big actors, when they've done big TV shows, they start to go to, like, Broadway. Case in point, like, Bryan Cranston just recently did The Network on Broadway, and I've heard that Peter Dinklage is thinking about taking a back to going to Broadway.
Who did Bryan Cranston play in Network?
What was it? Oh, my goodness. He played the main guy. Totally forgot.
Like the TV announcer?
Yeah, he played him.
I'm sure that's incredible.
Is that what he got the Tony for, or was that something else? Because I think he won a Tony.
I think he might have won a Tony for that one. I'm not actually sure.
Network is one of the best movies ever made, and that's one of the greatest characters ever written.
Howard Beale. Oh, my God. I totally am so upset that I forgot that.
I want you to get up and yell out your windows. I'm mad as hell.
I think Elf is the best movie ever made.
What? No, Seth, that is not the best movie ever made. The best movies ever made were The Lord of the Rings by Peter Jackson.
Hugh Jackman?
Sir Peter Jackson. Only his friends call him Peter Jackson.
Sir Peter Jackson, my mistake, sir.
Fellas, why do you think people who aren't fantasy fans fell in love with this show? Because there's no fantasy book selling 20 million copies, but there were 20 million people watching many of these episodes. So, like, what caused the crossover? Especially, I guess that's a question to Joey and Jose, because I know you're not fantasy people. Like, I know Harrison's a fantasy lover, as am I. So, mm-hmm. Like, what caused the crossover there?
I think maybe it's with the comp, like the basis common denominator, like a lot of nudity and sex sells.
I think I might have to agree, and also just the crazy violence. Because to be honest, there was a lot of points in Game of Thrones that were boring as fuck.
Yeah.
I would say the reason why Game of Thrones sold so well, in my opinion, and the reason I watched it, I mean, I had read the books beforehand, but for me, honestly, Sean Bean.
Yeah, that's probably it.
Yeah, but what kept you watching, though?
Oh, well, I had already... I think because I read the books, I read all the way up through A Feast for Crows before I watched the television show, so I really connected with some of the characters, and then there were some that when I screened, I was just mesmerized how well they did. So for me, like, my favorite characters from the books that transferred well to the TV show, you know, Ned Stark, Tywin Lannister... Tyrion Lannister, basically the whole Lannister family for the most part was excellently cast, and then there were just certain elements that I really liked and just kind of kept going. The nudity, honestly, I didn't care for. If I wanted to watch that, I could do something else. I mean, I just liked how well it connected to me to some of the characters that I liked in the book.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. The nudity was never to me a real big deal.
No, neither for me.
And I don't think really that there was any more nudity in Game of Thrones than any other cable television show.
Maybe people just kept watching the show just because they wanted to see Joffrey get killed. Like I remember back when I was in high school, I didn't watch the show, but my one buddy did. And every time I saw the show, every time I saw him and a new episode had aired, I went, "Is he dead? Is Joffrey dead yet?" He said, "Sorry, man." I was like, "Ah."
Do you think people hate watched it? You think people hate watched it?
Break it up, man. My
Do you think people hate watched it? I agree with that, actually.
Yeah, maybe, because I remember when Joffrey died, I was happy. I was so happy that he died. And then a couple seasons later, along comes, what's his face? Ramsay Bolton. I'm like, ooh, I cannot wait to watch you die.
Yeah, you think George just has this world of just gray morality until he gives you his actual true monsters, and they're just like, they make Jeffrey Dahmer look like a saint. It's crazy. Like,
and hey, you know, doubling back around, maybe that's why people had such a strong reaction to it, because First, your monster was Joffrey. Then your monster was Ramsay. And then, let's be honest, then your monster was Daenerys.
Yeah, totally. 100%.
Well, actually, I think it was more Cersei, the monster, because I was so happy when she got crushed to death.
Yeah, but what did Cersei actually do?
Well, besides the fact that she was a massive bitch and...
I think there were many.
She blew up the bloody set, man. Let's not forget that she committed an act of terrorism.
Well, yeah, I would say Cersei never actually committed any atrocity. She had other people do them for her, or she would play dumb.
Who is more guilty, sir? The man who gives the command to fire, or the man who pulls the trigger?
Well, according to
I got you thinking there.
You know, Cersei was one of the ones that tried to prevent Ned from getting beheaded back in season one.
I'm fairly certain she wanted him to get beheaded because he knew that she and Jaime were the true parents of Joffrey and her kid and the rest of her kids. And yeah, with that knowledge, he needed to die in order for her to be safe.
Well, but yeah, at least from the perspective from the show, it felt like when Joffrey just said, you know, execute him, there was a point where she was even trying to calm him down. And even in the books, there were times where she felt that she wasn't powerful enough or strong enough to stop her own, her own son from committing those atrocities. So I feel like there were some times where she played the victim.
He even makes a comment about how, before he passes a sentence about how, the something of women, the forgive over
the wails of women.
Is that what it was?
Yeah, it was the wails of women.
Yeah.
Isn't that what he named his sword?
Widow's Well.
That's the one I'm thinking of.
What a shitty name for a sword.
Widow's Wail.
I actually find Cersei to be one of the most sympathetic characters in the show, truth be told. Like,
Do tell.
Especially, when George Martin's writing her, I think she becomes a POV character in book 4. And you really understand her thought process and just how fucking bitter she is. How, like, she's clearly, I mean, Tyrion aside, like, those two, like, should have had a better connection because Tyrion can't be the heir because he's fucking deformed as far as their society's concerned. And she can't because she's female. But she's really, really smart, actually. And she can't... She can't exercise, power because she's... fucking woman, like, until, like, she's the last option, obviously, but
right. Here's my thing about Cersei is I think that Cersei paid her debt during her walk and everything that preceded that.
Yeah.
And then after that she would just have a revenge.
I think the wildfire in the what was it, the Seth the Baylor, I think that was her well-deserved revenge.
Yeah
I see that. Gentlemen, I actually have to let you guys go. I have an early shift first thing in the morning, and I can't believe I'm saying this, but I'm becoming an adult, so this is actually my bedtime now. It's 9 o'clock.
I hate to say it too, but I'm going to echo that, Kevin.
Oh, man. All right. Boy,
it's 9 o'clock where you are. It's 12:05 where I am.
We got enough material for another show, fellas. Let's do this again.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, shit. Jose, thanks for stopping by.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, and remember, if you get into any arguments, just tell them you got dragons and that their arguments are invalid.
Absolutely. Have a good night, gentlemen, and be safe, and God bless.
Likewise,
you
sir.
You too. Mm-hmm. See ya.
Joey, it sounds like you got a role as well.
Yeah.
Do you have 5 minutes to give me your... Just in case we don't come back around, do you have 5 minutes to give me your thoughts on the actual finale... the final last episode?
Sure. The final episode I think was fine. I think it was a good little, like, I think everything that needed to be wrapped up got wrapped up. I was even fine with Bran being king, whatever. Sansa being, queen of the north, okay. Arya's, or Adventures of Arya's. Okay, that's cool.
Just gonna go discover America.
Yeah,
Valinor heading off to the Undying Lands.
Exactly.
It was fine. I think my knee-jerk reaction, I think I mentioned, was I fucking hated it, but you know, it was the more I thought about it, the more I digested it. I think it was fine.
Yeah. Yeah, not the greatest finale I've ever seen, but not a total disaster the way people have said, I guess.
Did any of you guys ever watch Sons of Anarchy?
No, I can't say that I have.
I have not, but I've heard it's wonderful.
It was. The first four seasons, awesome. A lot of fun. But the last season in particular was a mess. It was god-awful. But they managed to somehow pull out a really, really damn good finale. And I think Game of Thrones kind of pulled that off here, too.
Yeah. Awesome, man. Mm-hmm. Well, let's do this again soon. This was a hell of a lot of fun. I know you got a roll.
It was. It was nice to meet you, Harrison.
Yeah, nice to meet you, too. Joey, was your name?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, maybe next time we'll do another multi-person stream.
Yes.
I'm so happy this came together. This was such an improvised thing. Like both Harrison and Jose were just in the chat, so I just invited them on. So
it worked out. It was a blast. We got to do this again soon.
Heck yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully with less technical issues next time.
Indeed.
That was not
the fun. All right, Joey. Sleep well, man. We'll talk soon.
You too, guys. All right. Bye.
Bye.
See ya. Bill, the story is just you and me.
Oh, and then there were two. Yeah, it was an interesting conversation. I know you saw at least some of it in the chat before you jumped in, but
yeah, you know, I was the first man in the chat, I think.
Yeah, right. I don't know, just from a writer's standpoint, there's so many like interesting complaints people have about this, like, oh, it was you know, things were dealt with too fast or whatever. And I'm like, I guess that's true. But like, I mean, they gave the White Walkers like an hour and a half. Like that's as long as a movie. You know what I mean? It's like, I think people aren't understanding the difference between, you know, mediums. Like you can give things time in the books as George is that you just don't have. You just flat out don't have in a TV show. So.
Yeah. Like. Let's be honest. Let's say, like, if you were to make a perfect, like adaptation of a novel,
yeah.
How long would that movie be? 20 hours, 24 hours, 72 hours long?
Probably one book. I would say three seasons of a TV show.
Just for one book.
Minimum. Absolute minimum. So yeah, that's a major problem that people have with, you know, and maybe, I don't know. It's why people always say, like, you've heard that, right? We're like, the book is better than the movie. It's like,
oh, I've heard that so many times.
For everything, right? And it's like, yeah, it usually is, but the reason is the book has more time to, like, clear its throat and give you all this, you know, time on things. Like, I think about, like, your books where, like, you... Like Tolkien, like you have time for songs, and you know that would never make it into the TV show, dude. You know what I mean?
Well, I like to think that if my stories were ever to be turned into an adaptation, that the filmmakers would put in the little tidbits, like just have the characters singing those songs in the background. Like,
yeah, I mean it's unlikely, and that it's
that's where those songs are in that one scene I wrote. You know, the big
dinner, right.
the big feast scene. And right. All those songs they were just being sung in the background.
And it's like, yeah, they wouldn't be focused on because that it's just such a different medium and such a different mode of storytelling. It's just the pace is like a book is a marathon and a TV show or a movie. Exactly. Everything's truncated right in here. So
although sometimes it does feel like a marathon. Case in point, the extended version of the Lord of the Rings, Return of the King. That thing is 4 hours long, 4 hours, 15 minutes, and some odd seconds.
And honestly, a little bit of that is just like us being trained. Like we've been trained to expect a shorter medium here. Like I saw some of these Game of Thrones episodes were 80 minutes, and I just sat down to watch it. I was like, oh, God. Whereas I'll happily read a 200,000-word novel, but which will take me like 10 times that length, but I sit down for an 80-minute TV show, and I'm just like, good God. Are you kidding me? Get off the stage.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, as you once told me, how the great Robert Ebert said, no good movie is too long, no bad movie is too short.
Exactly. Couldn't have said it better. Are you ever going to watch this show? Do you have any interest at all?
Game of Thrones, you mean?
Yeah.
Not really, man. Well, I only watch the battle scenes on YouTube and
right.
Obviously the dragons, because go dragons, they are the coolest thing ever.
Definitely.
Possibly not exist. Who knows?
Yeah.
Let's look at this way. Every culture in human history has had one dragon in it. Like, Chinese had dragons, the Europeans had dragons. I think there were a few African tribes who described,
yeah,
not dragons per se, but dragon-like creatures.
Do you think that's because they found dinosaur bones? Because I know that
yes,
theory's out there.
Possibly, yes, but who knows? Maybe they actually did see real dinosaurs, because I am a creationist, and actually, I believe there was this incident in 1980s where a bunch of paleontologists were looking at a femur bone of a Tyrannosaurus Rex, and they were looking at it, they chipped it away, and they found soft tissue inside.
Damn.
Yeah, I don't think soft tissue could survive 65 million years of fossilization.
Unlikely, for sure. I know that, like, people say that's why we have, like, the, you know, the story of the Cyclops, right? Is that they found, like, a woolly mammoth head, or a skull, rather. And if you've ever seen, like, an elephant skull, it's got
they have that dentation where the muscle for the trunk is.
Yeah, this big hole, right? And they're like, holy shit, that's an eye. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting to me. I'm sympathetic to your idea that perhaps these things actually existed and coexisted. I'd prefer to think that.
There is actually some footprints, I think, in Texas of a three-toed dinosaur, theropod dinosaur footprints, and running alongside it was human footprints.
Interesting.
Yeah, I'll have to find the photographs, so you can shoot you some on Facebook.
Yeah, send me that link.
Yeah. And who knows?
Well, my friend, it's always such a distinct pleasure, but I suppose I'd better kill this thing. We're coming up on 2.5 hours. Minus the technical difficulty time.
Yeah, minus the technical difficulty. It's not one of these streams unless we have one big tech headache.
Hell, why not three or four, like tonight? But
don't tempt fate.
Yeah, it was fun as hell getting you guys on. I'm so happy you were able to jump on. So
it was fun talking to your friends down there.
Awesome, man. Let's we'll do this again soon for sure. I'm gonna I'll kill our call and sign off our stream. In fact, if you want to give a sign off, be good, kiddos. Sure. The world-renowned historian. I am out.
All right. This has been your host, Harrison MacArthur, Draco the Dragon, signing off. Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen.
Love Bye-bye. It. Coup de grâce. All right. Bye.
My name's John Lee Pettymore, same as my daddy and his daddy before. Hardly ever saw granddaddy around here. Only come to town about twice a year. Buy 100 pound of yeast and some copper line. Everybody knew that he made moonshine. But the revenue man wanted granddaddy bad. Headed up the holler with everything he had. It was before my time, but I've been told never come back from Copperhead Road. Black Dodge, bought it from an auction at the Mason's Lodge. Johnson County Sheriff painted on the side. Shot a coat of primer, then he looked inside. Well, him and my uncle tore that engine down. Still remember that rumbling sound. Well, the sheriff came around in the middle of the night. Heard mama crying, knew something would ride. Headed down to Knoxville with the weekly load. Smell the whiskey burning down Copperhead Road.